you took the fall and thought of me.
Our second song will be In the Garden.
Song, Come Jesus Come.
Sometimes I fall to my knees and pray. Come, Jesus, come. Let today be the day. Sometimes I that won't fade. Come, Jesus, come. We've been waiting so long for the day you return to heal every hurt and right every wrong. We can turn this around. Deep down I know this world isn't home. Come, Jesus, come. Come, Jesus, come. One day you'll come and we'll stand face to face. Come and lay it all down. It might be today. The time is right now. There's no need to wait. Your past will be washed by rivers of grace. Jesus, come. We've been waiting so long for the day you return to heal every hurt and right every wrong. We need you right now. Come and turn this around. Down I know this world isn't home. Come, Jesus, come. Come, Jesus, come.
Thank you for singing.
It is now time for special prayer time. Get in groups of two or three and pray for the week of prayer, pray for the academy days coming up, and pray for Pastor Morgan. The Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for today. I want to thank you that we can all come here and be able to worship you. Please be with Pastor Morgan as he shares your message tonight. And be with us, open our hearts and ears to be able to hear your message. And be with the week of prayer as it keeps going. Help us be able to be blessed by your word. And be with the academy days that are coming up this weekend. Help them to be able to encourage kids to come to this school and know about you. I pray in name, amen.
Short, I've got nothing new. How
could I express all my gratitude?
I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing just one move with my arms stretched wide. I will worship you,
and I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a
so much. All right. One thing here. I don't know if I made a mistake a couple days ago or yesterday when I said I'd work out with as many of you as I could, because I worked out three times today with different groups, so don't touch me, because it's going to be a rough day tomorrow. But anyway, let's dig right in. Let's pray. Father, we want to know your voice. We want to know your word. And this morning we talked about what your word means and the reality that your word brings and the potential that your word brings, not just for our earth, but for us. And Father, as we look at your word more tonight, we ask that you would bless us, be with any distractions that may be distracting us, and may we be focused not on the preacher, but we would be focused on what it is that you would have us to learn. We pray in your name. Amen. So this morning, wasn't that long ago, we talked about the creative Word of God and the power that the Word of God brings. The Word of God is reality. So when God said, "Let dry land appear," that became the reality. When God said, "Let the sun, moon, and stars shine in the firmament," that became the reality. So God cannot lie, because when God speaks, that becomes not just fact, but it becomes the reality, and there's so much more potential that God creates when he looks at his creation. Another thing we looked at was that when God creates, he doesn't just create it and then set it on a shelf, but God is very invested in his creation, especially his human creation, and where he's placed his human creation to live on this world. And so the Word of God not only created us, but the Word of God gives us potential, especially when we follow his Word. As human beings, we have the freedom of choice, right? And God has given us time. God has given us energy. God has given us minds that think. God has given us all the tools that we need for that good potential. But unfortunately, with good potential can also come bad potential, depending on how we look at things. But if we follow the Word of God, of course, we know that he will never steer us wrong. You know, one of the things, I mentioned this morning, one of the things that you've been asking me a lot is, how do I know the voice of God and how can I hear his voice? We're going to be looking at a story today where we see Jesus do battle with Satan himself. And we find not just the voice of God present, but how Jesus discerns what is true and what is error. So if you have your Bibles with you, and I hope that you do, please turn to the book of Matthew. We're going to be in the book of Matthew for the majority of tonight. So Matthew, and we'll look at chapter 3 here tonight. Matthew chapter 3, Jesus is about 30 years old. He goes to the River Jordan. He meets his cousin there, John the Baptist, and Jesus is baptized there in the Jordan River. Matthew chapter 3, we see this take place starting here in verse 15. John, of course, is saying, no, I don't want you to baptize, I don't want to baptize you, I want you to baptize me. And Jesus says it needs to happen. But in Matthew chapter 3, starting in verse 15, it says, "And Jesus answering said to him," John the Baptist, "Suffer it be so now, for thus it becomes us to fulfill all righteousness." Verse 16, "And Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon him, and a voice from heaven saying," now notice this, because we're going to be paying attention to this phrase a lot, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." We know that story. So this is one of the few places in the New Testament that we find the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit all present in one place. And it's at the baptism of Jesus. Now, Desire of Ages gives us a little bit of insight on what happens here, because that voice that comes down from heaven that says, "This is my beloved Son," was not only heard by Jesus, but it was heard by some of the others in the crowd as well. Interestingly enough, not everybody in the crowd heard the voice saying, "This is my beloved Son," but some did. Desire of Ages makes it clear too, and I think the Bible alludes to this, that there was one in particular being that was focused on what was happening on the banks of Jordan that day, and it was the devil himself. Satan was there, of course, because he had had his eyes on Jesus for a while. He had tried to kill him at his birth. He had tried to kill him when he was a little bit younger. He had been ridiculed by his brothers and sisters, and now he was the age of a man, and he is there, and the devil is locked in seeing what is happening with the life of Jesus. Jesus is baptized, he comes up out of the water, and the pronouncement is made by God the Father, the voice of God, the audible voice of God, saying, "This is my Son, and I love this guy." Not only does he love Jesus, the Father, but he approves of what the Son is doing. Some people in the crowd hear that, but the devil hears that too. And of course, Jesus hears that as well. Now, what immediately follows this is interesting. Matthew chapter 4, as soon as he is baptized, look what Jesus does next. 4 verse 1. "Then when Jesus was led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterwards hungry. Now, I love the Bible when it does this sometimes, because it makes a statement like, Jesus didn't eat anything for 40 days. And by the way, he was hungry. It's like, yeah, makes sense, right? He hasn't eaten for 40 days. Of course he's hungry. But the Bible wants you to know that Jesus is at physically a very weak point. Let me ask you a question. How many of you, when you skip a meal or you skip a couple meals, get a little bit irritable? Yes or no? Yeah, of course, right? I think the term for that is hangry, right? When we're hungry and we skip some meals, we tend to get irritable. Maybe our emotions start to get all over the place. When you've lacked some sleep as well. You know, it's interesting because the devil loves to tempt us, especially when we're lacking a few things, especially in our health. So for instance, if you're lacking sleep and you're lacking food, you don't think quite right. And the devil loves to attack you right then and there when you're at your physical weak point, which means that your mind isn't where it should be. Jesus has been fasting and praying for 40 days, which means his body is weakened, but he's been talking to his Father for 40 days, right? So spiritually, Jesus is in a very strong place because he wasn't just skipping meals on purpose. He was doing this to draw closer to his Father and to hear his voice better. All right, so these 40 days pass. Jesus is in the wilderness. The devil has not approached him, the Bible says, yet. These 40 days goes of communing Jesus with the Father. Interestingly enough, and this is a little bit of a side note, Jesus fulfills a lot of the wanderings, not really the wanderings, but the story of the Old Testament Jews as they come out of Egypt. It's interesting, the first baptism in the Bible that we have reference to, and the New Testament tells us this, when the Israelites left Egypt and they crossed the Red Sea, right, when it split open, the Bible tells us that that was a baptism of the people of God. As soon as they get out of the Red Sea, what do? They wander in the wilderness for how long? 40 years, right? So Jesus becomes baptized by John the Baptist, and then what does he do? He goes into the desert. Now, he doesn't have 40 years to spare, right? But he has 40 days. So he's following the track record of the children of Israel, except for a minor detail. Jesus is not wandering. Jesus is there for a reason. He's intentional about his time there with his Father. Satan waits until Jesus is probably at his weakest physically, and then he strikes. Now, I want you to notice what the temptation of Satan is. Now, let's look at this. Matthew chapter 4, verse 3. And when the tempter came to him, he said, now before we go on, I just want to paint a picture for you here. Jesus, the creator, the one that created heaven and earth, the one that spoke things into existence, like we talked about this morning, at some point in time, created the tempter. Like Jesus was there when Lucifer, he wasn't a tempter at that point, of course, we understand that, but Jesus was there at Lucifer's first day. Jesus had spent time with Lucifer for we don't know how long, but there was a relationship that had been there. Of course, now Jesus has become man. I don't know what kind of memory that Jesus has. I don't know if he had any at all, but Jesus knows that when the tempter comes to him, this is someone that he created who knows how long ago. He knows that he spent time with this man behind the gates of heaven. And now this fallen angel is coming, not just to tempt humanity, but the audacity, he's come to tempt the very Son of God, God himself. Except God is at his weakest point that he has ever been, because divinity has taken on human flesh. And this human flesh for 40 days has not eaten anything. So God in human form is at a very vulnerable point. Jesus is on the ropes, so to speak. And Satan sees that vulnerability. And so he shows up in an angel of light, which Jesus sees right through. Now notice again what the temptation is. We didn't read it. Verse 3, we'll read the first part. And when the tempter came to him, he said, now notice this. If you be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Okay, I've read this story a lot, and I always thought that the temptation was about the bread. And that always confused me because, yeah, I know that Jesus wasn't allowed to use his own power to benefit himself. I understand that. But what was the point of this temptation that Satan was tempting Jesus with? I mean, yeah, he was hungry. Bread would have been nice, but something's got to be deeper. And it's not like that eating bread is a sin either, right? It's not like Satan said, turn these stones into Budweiser, right? Or turn these stones into a pork chop or something like that. That's not what Satan said. He said, turn these stones into some simple bread. There's got to be something deeper behind this temptation than just turning stones into bread. And I believe that turning the stones into bread is just a decoy behind what the actual temptation of Satan was. It's at the early part of this statement. Remember what the statement was. He says, if you be the Son of God, do this act. This is where I want us to spend time tonight. What had just happened? Okay, we just see Jesus in the wilderness. He's been there for 40 days. What just happened approximately 40 days before this event? We just read it. Jesus was what? He was baptized, right? And what was the word that came from heaven? This is my Son in whom I'm pleased. Fast forward 40 days later, Satan comes to Jesus, and I'm kind of putting this in my paraphrase now. Satan says something like this. So I was there on the banks of the Jordan that day. And I was there as John was baptizing people. And then you showed up. And I know that people are saying that you possibly might be this Messiah figure. Obviously, the Jews don't think that you are because you look like nothing of the part. You don't really come from royal lineage. Yeah, you're a son of David, but you're not what they're looking for. You're not a violent person. You're not even a good-looking person. This is not the Messiah that the Jews have been talking about for a long time. And supposedly, you're the Son of God. You're the Messiah figure. And sure, I heard this voice come down from heaven. But Jesus, I'm not so sure. Are you really the Son of God? Because you don't really look like it. Notice what Satan is doing. Satan is not only trying to get Jesus to doubt the voice or the creative word of God, but Satan is also trying to get Jesus to question his identity as the Son of God. Now, let me ask you if Satan has ever done anything like this to you before. You claim to be a Christian. I think many of you do, if not all of you. Has Satan ever gotten into your mind? And I talked a little bit about this morning in one of the classes. How many of you have what they call an internal dialogue? You have that in your mind? Like when you think there's like a conversation that's running? A lot of people think like that, right? How many of you, when you're having your inner dialogue and you're thinking, and you might be thinking some deep thoughts, maybe you're thinking about spirituality, how many of you have ever had the thought come into your brain of something like, yeah, you call yourself a Christian, but really? You? You really call yourself a child of God? Now, the devil loves to do this. The devil loves to say things like, see, I know what children of God look like. I know how children of God are supposed to act. I know how children of God are supposed to think. And I've been watching you. I see what goes on, what actions that you make, what words you say, and I have a good idea even about what thoughts you might think. And I'm pretty sure that you do not fit the bill of a child of God. Satan loves to question. He loves to get us to question the identity of who we are. I'm here to tell you today that if you have invited Jesus in your heart, that you are a child of God. Amen? Like, is that not good news? That you can call yourself children of God? That's an amazing thing. And when you invite Jesus into your heart, he already loves you before you've even done that. We saw this morning that God creates people by the word of his mouth. And when God creates someone, he's invested in them. So we know that God already loves us, but when we say, Lord, I want you to live in my heart, God says, you've been my child already. Now you're claiming your identity of who you really are. But Satan doesn't want us to have that identity. He wants us to gain that identity of who we are, the basis of who we are, somewhere else. He likes us to base our personality on something else, or some other belief system, or whatever it may be, as long as we do not identify or think that we fit the part of a child of God. And this is the temptation of Jesus. It's not about turning stones into bread. We'll see that in just a minute. But the temptation here is questioning the voice of God. And I'm here to tell you today, and I think this is very true, and I think it's something that each and every one of you should know. And I don't want to sound like a heretic or anything like that, but even when you make a mistake, you are still a child of God. Amen? Even when you sin and mess up royally, trust me, I've done my share of that, and I still will continue to. Even if you mess up royally, you are still a child of God. Now, this might sound a little bit interesting, but people that do not make it to heaven, people that are going to die the second death and not exist anymore, they're still children of God. You know why? Because God created them. Every single person that God has created, which last time I checked was everyone, everyone is a child of God. The difference between someone that is saved and someone that is lost is if they claim their real identity and invite their Creator to live in their heart. That's the difference between a child of God that recognizes who they are and a child of God that wants nothing to do with their origin story. And yeah, your origin story might be your parents. Of course, it's your parents. But back up before your parents. Your origin story was somewhere in heaven when God the Father was talking to the rest of the Godhead. And I believe this. I believe that God said, I think we need to create somebody just like this. And you were born. You were created because of the living Word of God. Is that not amazing? That's where we came from. And we are children of God, and Satan wants us to either not believe that or reject that. And that's what he's trying to get Jesus to do. He's trying to say, yeah, I heard God say that you were his child, but I don't believe it. Now, here's the thing. Now, this is wild. He says this. We already read it, verse 4, but I'm reading it again because I'm a little slow. But he answered and said, it is written, when the tempter came to him, he said, if you be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Now, here's what it is, guys. What Satan is trying to do is to get Jesus to doubt who he is. And in order for him, the temptation is, in order for him to prove who he is, he has to do a certain action. And that action could have been anything. He tempts Jesus two more times. We'll talk about this a little bit later. But the temptation is, I don't believe that you're a child of God. Prove it to me. And then I'll believe it. And then if you prove it to me, then you might believe it too. Here's the thing, guys. We get this so backwards as Christians. How many of us keep the commands of God because we doubt who we are? And so we do the right thing, not because of the right thing, but because we're trying to prove to ourselves that we might be good people. We go to church on Sabbath, we read our Bibles, we do our devotions, we attempt a prayer life, not because we necessarily care about a relationship with God, but we hear the voice of Satan saying, "Are you really sure that you're a Christian? Why don't you do these things?" And they might even be good things. Do these things, and then you can prove to yourself and everybody around you that you are a child of God. That's not how that works. You're a child of God when you were created. Amen? That's who you are. That's at your basic level. And the reason that we do the things that God asks us to do is because we recognize that He loves us. Amen? And we recognize that He died for us. And because this is the kind of God that He is, and He uses His word to pronounce of who we are, we do those things not to prove anything, but we do those things to show that we love God. Amen? Our actions are going to prove nothing. Of course, works are important. I'm not trying to downplay that. But we often put the cart before the horse, right? We look at it backwards. And notice what Jesus does. Jesus does not turn the stones into bread. But notice what He says. And I just think this is so powerful. Verse 4. But He answered and said, notice this, "It is written." Now, I want to pause here. We're going to look at this a little bit tomorrow. But Jesus faces three temptations, right? And all three temptations, He answers with Scripture. And all three of the answers that He gives from the book of Deuteronomy. Still don't know why He's quoting the book of Deuteronomy. All three times. My best answer is, maybe He was reading Deuteronomy for His devotions that morning. I don't know. But He reads, or He quotes Deuteronomy for all three of these temptations for whatever reason. But notice what He says. He answered and said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." Now, I always misunderstood this, or I didn't misunderstand it. I just didn't have a deeper look at this. Sure, when Jesus says, "Man shall not live by bread alone," it ties into the temptation of turn these stones into bread. I get that. That's cute. But it's deeper than that. It's not just about the bread. And sometimes we get focused on that. But this is what it is, guys. Jesus says, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by what? Every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Now, this is what's wild. The temptation that Satan had for Jesus was this: "You don't look the part. I don't buy it. I don't think that you are the Messiah, let alone a child of God. Prove it to me." And what does Jesus respond with? Jesus responds by saying simply this: "God already told me who I am." Amen? I mean, what did he hear 40 days prior to this? "This is my son, and I am well pleased with him." This was still ringing in the ears of Jesus and also in the ears of Satan. So Jesus comes back to Satan. This temptation happens, and Jesus says this: "I don't care what you say. The only thing I care about is what my father said. And I'm pretty sure that 40 days ago, my father told me who I am. He told me that I am the Son of God. And if there was any doubt in my mind of who I was or who I am, that solidified it for me because God spoke. And God said, 'This is my son.'" And remember what we heard about the word of God? God's word is what? It's reality. So I don't need any other word. I don't need any other bread. Let alone, I don't need your opinion. What does my father say? And that was enough for Jesus. That was all he needed, was to hear and to read what the word of God said. Now notice what Jesus doesn't do. Jesus doesn't say, 40 days ago, my father told me. He heard the audible voice of God 40 days prior to this. And instead of going back to that example of what had just happened, he quotes Scripture. Why doesn't Jesus just say, 40 days ago my dad told me this? He could have, and he wouldn't have been wrong in that. But I love that Jesus quotes an ancient Scripture because not all of us have heard the audible voice of God. And we ask ourselves the question, how do I fend off the temptations of Satan? How do I know that the voice that's going on in my head when I'm having that inner dialogue, how do I know that that's coming from God, or it's coming from myself, or it's coming from some other place that I don't really want anything to do with? What does God have to say? Jesus quoted Scripture that you have access to as well. And if it was good enough for Jesus to refute, it was good enough for us. Amen? All Jesus cared about was the Word of God. And the Word of God said, "This is my Son," and that's all that Jesus needed. Let's go back to this morning. The Word of God. This? By the way, we know that this book was inspired by God's Word. Amen? That's why we call it the Word of God. And the crazy thing about this book, and it's not just a book, this book is living because God spoke it into existence. This is God's message to us. This is how He speaks to us. This is where we get our identity. This is how we answer the temptations of Satan and the things that's going on in our life that we're struggling with. But let's think back to this morning here before we close. Remember, we agreed that God's Word is reality. God's Word is not the thought of reality. God's Word is not planning reality to happen, but God's Word is what happens. And we agreed this morning that when God said, "Let dry land appear," that's what took place. We saw this morning that when God said, "Let the birds fly in the air," that's what happened. We believe, or at least we say we believe, that when God says something, that's what happens. Until it comes to us. We have no problem with God's creative power when it comes to the earth or maybe other people. But when it comes to what God says about us, if we're honest with ourselves, we often struggle believing Him. Not only about being the child of God, we struggle with that. But when we ask God for forgiveness for something that we have done that's wrong, often we ask Him, and I'm going to be real with you guys, I've asked forgiveness for things that I have done, and in my head, I believe that God has forgiven me of those things because that's what the Bible says. It's the Word of God. But sometimes those things that I have done still keep me up at night. We talked about having an internal dialogue. Does that internal dialogue sometimes replay when you're going to bed at night? And you see scenes of what happened that day that you shudder at? Yeah, sure, embarrassing moments maybe, but things that you know that you did wrong. For anything like me, sometimes it doesn't replay the previous day or that day, but sometimes for whatever reason, I replay a scene that happened 10 years ago. And in my mind, I know that God has forgiven me. But sometimes I still question that. And that's so wrong because I believe that God's Word is reality. I understand that here. But I guess it's hard to believe. It's almost too good to be true that God has forgiven me for something that I'm deeply ashamed of. And if I don't believe that the spoken Word of God can forgive me, and if I don't believe that the spoken Word of God can change my heart, in essence, what I'm saying is that I believe that the power of sin is more powerful than the Word of God. And again, logically, doctrinally, I know that that's not true. I know that the Word of God is more powerful than sin. I understand that. It all connects up here. But to make that a part of my reality, to make that a part of my spiritual life, it's a struggle, guys. It's a struggle because on this earth, oftentimes, sin is just what we know. It's what we see day in and day out. And we know that God is good and God is powerful and all of these things, but could it be that God actually has made me a better person? Could it be that I could actually overcome something? Could it be that God actually has forgiven someone like me? This is exactly what Peter and Judas struggled with. You know, Peter actually was forgiven. He finally recognized it and praised the Lord. Judas came to a point he didn't think he could be forgiven anymore and went down another path that we don't like to talk about. The creative power of God. The Word of God. What is it? If you bring anything away from tonight, and if you've been sleeping, wake up now for the next two sentences. Believe this, that if you ask God for forgiveness, you are forgiven. Amen? Amen? If you truly repent and ask God to forgive you, that is the reality, because it's the Word of God. Also, God has declared each and every one of you His child. Believe that. That is the basis, that is the foundation of who you are. That's where you have your identity. That's where you get your value. That's where you get everything, is knowing that you were created by God Himself. The spoken word of God that created this world created you. Believe it. Act like it. Walk like it. God is your Father. And you are here because God wanted you to be here. You're here for a purpose. What is that purpose? Why does God have you alive now? Why does God have you alive on this campus? Why has God brought you here? Why has God allowed certain things to happen in your life? That's the question. That's the million-dollar question. And that's something that you have to ask God for. Why am I here? What's my path? And you are all in a critical time in your life where you're thinking about what you're going to do in your future. Some of you are seniors, and this is the last few weeks that you're going to be here, and you're asking yourself, what am I going to do with my future? Why am I here? Why has God put me here? Why have I gone through the things that I've gone through? What is the point of my life? Let me be talking about that. But I want you to know before we continue in our journey together about the Word of God that you are not a mistake. Amen? You are not a mistake. You are not just a number. You are something to God. And you are His child. Why? Because He said it. That's all we need. Let's pray. Father, You are good. And in that, we have all the confidence in the world. Things get brought at us that discourage us. Satan often enters our inner dialogue and throws in confusion and doubts. But may we claim Your word, and may we know that Your creative word that created this world thousands of years ago is still in the business of performing miracles and creating new hearts and new minds today. We pray in Your name. Amen.